What's up, Rams fans? Welcome back to Rams Showcase. Tonight, the franchise tag window is open. Will the LA Rams use it? Plus, the LA Rams aren't the only NFC West team that could see a change in the quarterback position this offseason. And later, we answer some fan quesos. Next on Rams Showcase.
Welcome to Rams Showcase on Sports War Radio.
What's going on, Rams fans? Welcome back to Rams Showcase right here on Sports War Radio. I'm your host, Joe Brandon, but you can and should call me Sheriff Joe Bags, and I am laying down the law for you guys tonight. We got some cool stuff to talk about. We are really getting into off-season stuff here, though, which is exciting. I don't hate it at all. It's just we're getting a little bit thin on the actual breaking news aspect of it, but we are doing just fine. We got plenty to talk about tonight, and also some fan cases on the back end here that are strong. I got some really good fan cases. I love the fan cases. It's one of my favorite segments to do. We got some really good ones for you guys. I appreciate everybody who drops those. If you guys ever want me to answer your questions on the show, I try to get to all of them. It's very rare that I don't get to answer a question. Sometimes if there's just a billion of them, I have to cut some. But usually I've got plenty plenty of time and everything to get to them. So if you guys have questions, wherever you're listening to me, go ahead and drop them there, and I will answer them on the following episode, all right? And there's going to be times during this offseason that we kind of just take some fan quesos. If maybe I'm getting a whole bunch of them or something like that, we'll maybe just do like that. We'll just pump out a fan queso episode, basically. But either way, you guys can feel free to drop them. I will answer them on the following episode no matter what, unless, like I said, I get just a way too many of them because I can't just answer fan quesos for like 3 hours. I do have to do other things. So we do have some good stuff to talk about this week. And as the offseason goes on, we do have some storylines that we're going to be following. One of which is the Rams quarterback situation. Now that Matt Stafford is going to be slinging the rock for the LA Rams and Sean McVay's offense. But like I said a little bit ago, we do have some changes going on potentially in the other NFC West teams. So that being said, what we are bringing back is a segment that I haven't done in quite a while, actually. It's called Rest of the West. Very simple segment title. You know, I didn't strain any brain muscles or whatever thinking of that one. But either way, we got Rest of the West. That'll come up here in a little bit. But first, I think we need to talk about this franchise tag window that we have now entered. It started yesterday, which was Tuesday. If you guys are watching the video version of this, it was at least 2 days ago. We are on Thursday, if you guys are watching the video. But today, in the world that I am being recorded, is Wednesday. So it started yesterday. We have not seen any come in yet, at least not that I've seen. I also was at work all day. So keep that in mind. I don't only check Twitter, you know, I do other things. And so I haven't seen any come in at all. But if we're looking at the LA Rams here, which is what we do here on Rams Showcase, there's two candidates in my mind that are possible to get the franchise tag. And we talked about this last week. I'm not going to keep the secret here. It's linebacker Leonard Floyd and it's safety John Johnson. Everybody else, it doesn't really make a lot of sense. It wouldn't make a lot of sense to put a franchise tag on them, make them the highest or the average of the highest paid five at their position. That wouldn't make a lot of sense for any of the other names that the Rams have coming up as free agents, as unrestricted free agents, such as like the Morgan Foxes of the world and such. So I just don't think that that's something that the Rams would do. I don't think that's a course they would take. Some of these guys I do think get extended. I think that the Rams do wiggle around. It's always possible to get under the cap. There's always ways. You know, I know that we're over the cap right now, but there's always a way to get that number back down to where it's legal according to league rules. So don't worry about that at all. I do, however, think that some of these guys will be back getting extended, even though we are currently over the cap and will need to be under the cap by March 17th at 2 o'clock Joe time, which is the start of the new league year, which would be 1 o'clock LA time, Ram time. And 2 o'clock Joe time for you New Yorkers and the rest of you guys on that coast over there. You guys can do your powers of deduction for the Central Time Zone. if you guys need to do that. So the franchise tag, the window's now open. It's going to be open for a little bit of time here, up until the 17th. And I just don't see this being used. Like I said, the two candidates are John Johnson and Leonard Floyd. I just don't think it gets used this year by the LA Rams. I don't think that the Rams fork out that money on a franchise tag. I think that if the Rams do want John Johnson or Leonard Floyd back, I think it would be in the form of an extension, not a franchise tag. I also do, though, in fairness, I do think that both of these players walk. I think that we let them both go. And honestly, and like I said, I've said this a few times on the show, actually, I really do think that both of these guys go to the Chargers. And a big part of that is now that Brandon Staley is over there. But I think I think they both fit in over there. The Chargers have, they can afford both of these guys. They would overpay for Leonard Floyd. Anybody would overpay for Leonard Floyd at this point, though. And it's not, I'm not trying to knock Leonard Floyd. I think that the way that the Rams defense is set up with guys like Jalen Ramsey and Aaron Donald, I mean, those two levels, having one of the top, maybe the top at each respective position, maybe Ramsey's the best corner in the game. That title typically only lasts for about 3 years, 3-4 years, for somebody who's really at their peak. Like, do you remember like when Aqib Talib was at the peak, or when it was Revis Island at the peak, you know, that it really only lasted a couple of years. So we'll see if Ramsey can hold it down, but he might be the best at that position today. And Aaron Donald, you know, he's my age, which makes me real sad, but he's also, I mean, I don't think there's really too much debate that could be had on him being the best defensive lineman. There are names that you could throw into that argument, but I think that you could always win the argument with Aaron Donald. And I think that argument is won on tape. It's not won with words. It's not won with three Defensive Player of the Year awards. It's not won with any of that stuff. It's won with the tape. And if you watch him play, I mean, there's no plays off. It's insane how fast he can get around these guys, and he's stronger than everybody else on the field every time he's on the field. So I think you can win those debates with tape. But that being said, I think that plays into the fact that Leonard Floyd had a really good season, his best season as a pro under Brandon Staley, who the only reason Floyd played for the Rams was because of Brandon Staley. He coached him in Chicago. And I think that plays a big factor. Also, another factor that we talked about last week, we touched on it briefly, we'll touch on it briefly again here, is that Dante Fowler had a strong season with the LA Rams and then went to Atlanta and played just okay. You know, he didn't really light anything up down there. So I think that those things do need to be considered. Anybody, I think, would overpay for Leonard Floyd right now. I'm not going to be super sad if he does not return back to the LA Rams. But he brings a lot. I mean, he fits in with the LA Rams, but so did Dante Fowler. So I would like to have him back. I think that if he goes anywhere else, he's going to be overpaid for what he will produce in that sense. John Johnson, he's going to get paid, and he's going to deserve it all because that guy is awesome. And I've seen some fans talk about John Johnson, that he had a down year. I'm not sure what you guys are seeing with John Johnson having a down year. His stats maybe dipped a little bit, but that's because he's better in coverage. Why do you think Jalen Ramsey, who we literally just talked about, I said was maybe the best cornerback of the game, had one interception this year? It's because no one's going to him. You don't throw on a guy that's that insane, you know what I mean? So I think that has to be taken into consideration. I don't think John Johnson had a down year by any means at all. Statistically, maybe had, you know, fewer interceptions, fewer pass breakups than his averages. But I think that really plays into the fact that, A, the Rams secondary was absolutely mean. It was rude to quarterbacks all around the league. And John Johnson was a big part of that. So was Jalen Ramsey. So was, you know, Jordan Fuller. So was Troy Hill. So was Darius Williams. So a lot of names factor into that. John Johnson, though, amazing player. I think he's going to get paid really, really well wherever he goes. And I think he deserves it. I don't think that the Rams can afford him. I think he played himself out of the Rams because we are already in a weird cap situation that no one truly understands how it's all going to work out all the time. I just know that there's always a way to fix it. There's always a way that you're going to be fine. And I kind of hang on to that because I know that Les McAdeal Sneed over there is going to do a fine job, and he's going to work some numbers. And I'm guessing that guys like Ramsey and Donald and Kupp and Woods restructure their deals, get some of that money transferred into bonus money, stuff like that, and lower that cap number. I just think that that's what happens. But I would love to see John Johnson back as an LA Ram. I don't think any of us would not want to see John Johnson back as an LA Ram. He's an amazing player. But either way, I think that I don't think the Rams bring either of these guys back, but I also don't think that the franchise tag is used. There is one situation that I could see with John Johnson is if the Rams already know that he is getting a lot of attention, is trying to slap on like a franchise tag and then trade, like your good old-fashioned tag and trade scenario where we would kind of put another team in a weird situation of having to work a deal. But either way, I mean, we would get something out of it, you know, something at all out of it. And that could be something that happens quick. It could be something like, hey, okay, we got, if we tag him, we got this trade deal set up over here. I also don't think that that would include a lot of draft picks. I realize that some fans are like, let's tag Johnson, trade him for a one. I don't think that that happens for a couple of reasons. I don't think that the Rams really value ones that much, which I think is a little bit clear. I shouldn't be blowing anybody's mind with that. Like, me saying that sentence shouldn't make you at home be like, what? Why wouldn't we value ones? It's very clear that the Rams really don't value ones, but other teams do. And that's why we're so willing to give them away, is because, hey, if you want a one, that's a coin toss on if that guy is going to be decent or not. And, you know, if we can trade two coin tosses of a guy that might be good, might contribute, for a guy that we know can contribute, such as a Matt Stafford, we can get rid of two ones, two coin tosses that are probably, well, Rams are a good team right now, probably 20s, hopefully 30s picks here in the next couple of years, that you throw away those two coin tosses for a guy that you think is a better quarterback, that gives you a better chance to win more games and bump up those numbers as far as the making that draft pick a little bit later. You do that. And I don't see any reason that fans would be upset about these trades coming in. That's one thing that I have seen that a few times, a fan saying, let's tag John Johnson, try to get a one out of it. I don't want a one. We don't need them. I mean, first round picks are, it might just be the Rams fan in me saying this, but first round picks are overrated, and we're doing fine without them. Without a first round pick, the Rams are going to the playoffs 75% of the time. And until that comes back and bites us, I'm here for it, guys. I'm here for the, I'm here for the trading the ones and just living our lives, going to the playoffs. And the 1 year, by the way, because that's 4 years now that we haven't had a first round pick. That 1 year was a year that the Rams went 9-7 and barely missed. And if Greg Zuerlein kicks the field goal against the Seattle Seahawks in week 4 in Seattle to win that game, then the Rams are a playoff team. I mean, of course, if that happens, the rest of the season changes. But still, if that kick goes in, the Rams are more than likely in the postseason. And also, it was 1 year before the added playoff team. So if the added playoff team was a thing in that year, the Rams also would have been to the playoffs. So the 75%, it could have very easily become 100% if just a couple of small things happened. So I'm not hating it right now, and until it comes back to bite the Rams, I'm okay with giving up the ones. Let's take a look at a rumor here. I just wanted to touch on this one because obviously we're in Rumorville right now. We are living in Rumorville. Population NFL fans all over the world. All right, and this is just the time of year. It's February. Everybody, we just got done watching the season. We just got done watching the Super Bowl, and now we haven't seen cuts yet. We haven't seen re-signings yet. Everything is still like super fresh, so we are in prime rumor real estate right now, and everybody's like really vibing on the rumors right now. I've seen this rumor a couple of times, and I've seen it touched on from a few different angles, and I want to let you guys know my thoughts on this one. Okay, so the rumor is that the Rams are interested in wide receiver DeSean Jackson, who was recently cut from the Philadelphia Eagles. And I've tried to kind of trace this rumor back, which is typically what I do when I hear a rumor is, you know, I can see a Rams publication posting that a rumor is out there, but I could make up rumors if I wanted to. I could say that the Rams are looking at trading Matt Stafford for Russell Wilson. It doesn't mean it has any weight. So I try to trace these rumors back to where they started from. And it turns out that this one actually, it looks like it started from an article that was actually titled Three Teams That Should Be Interested in DeSean Jackson, not Three Teams That Are Interested in DeSean Jackson. And I thought that was kind of interesting because this has happened to me before when I used to write articles before Rams Showcase started. I used to write articles about the Rams, And there was a couple of times that this actually, this misunderstanding of a headline got me in a little bit of trouble. I remember specifically, my article was titled, Rams Position Needs That Are Not Quarterback. Because at the time, that was the entire conversation, was that the Rams needed a quarterback. And it made perfect sense. This was before the Rams drafted Jared Goff, and we were in like the Case Keenum, Sean Hill, Austin Davis, that little realm right there. And that was my whole point was that there are other position needs. And the way that I worded it, Rams position needs that are not quarterback, but that got misread by many people, and I can't say that it's anybody's fault but my own because of how many people misunderstood the headline. And I think people were reading it as Rams don't need a quarterback, which was very interesting to me. And I had to explain it so many times. And I think that that's exactly what happened here was people were reading my headline is Rams don't need a quarterback. Rams other position needs, you know, the position needs that are not the Rams position needs are not quarterback kind of thing is how I think it was being read. Even though that was not the wording of it. So this one's saying three teams that should be interested in Jackson, not three teams that are interested in Jackson. And the more I thought about this rumor and everything, and I traced it back to that, and I was like, okay, that makes total sense that people would just misunderstand that because we're in a headline culture right now. Social media has taken over big time, and people will pick out headlines and then form an entire opinion of their stance and everything based on just what that headline says, whether it's misleading or not. They don't read the entire article and really get the in-depth information. So they see the article. Maybe you're just scrolling and you see interested Jackson Rams, you know, and then you're just like, oh, the Rams are interested in DeSean Jackson. And this happens. And I've been on the other side of that, too. I'm not trying to like blame anybody here, but I've been on that side of it, too, where it's like, hey, you know what? Oh, crap. Like, this is big news or whatever. And then, you know, end up just kind of, I always read the article. I'm an article reader. I know it takes longer and you get, you know, more information and everything, but I always kind of look into it. So the more I thought about this one, though, this one specifically, because it was like, okay, DeSean Jackson, like we say, the Rams were interested in DeSean Jackson. I don't think that the Rams are not interested in DeSean Jackson. I just don't think that they're actually going to pursue him. But I don't think that the Rams are like, DeSean Jackson, absolutely not. Get him out of here kind of thing. I just believe that the Rams are just not going to make a push for him. But the more I thought about this rumor, DeSean Jackson to the LA Rams, the more I think it's just completely unnecessary. The Rams don't need DeSean Jackson. What does DeSean Jackson bring to the LA Rams that we can't find in a younger player? I don't know. The experience, of course, yeah. But, I mean, Marvin Jones already has a history with Matt Stafford, and but it seems like both sides are pretty mutually interested as far as the Marvin Jones to the Rams scenarios go. But I don't see a reason why the Rams would want DeSean Jackson when Marvin Jones is already, I mean, kind of locked in on the LA Rams. And I think we are kind of counting our chickens before they hatch a little bit with the Marvin Jones thing. But I mean, it's mutual interest. And we already kind of know that. We know that Jones and Stafford are in communication. We know that Jones wants to play for the Rams. He's not hiding that fact. And the Rams, we know, are probably not going to bring back Josh Reynolds. So we kind of have a spot open. So I it makes total sense that the Rams would go with Marvin Jones. It makes a lot of sense to lose Reynolds and add Jones. It does not make any sense to me to lose Reynolds and add Jackson. Or to lose Reynolds, add Jones, and add Jackson. That makes the least sense to me. If Marvin Jones becomes an LA Ram, I am very confident that DeSean Jackson will not be. Of course, don't take my words as absolute gold, because I was sitting here on Ram Showcase just a couple of years ago saying, I see no way Aqib Talib becomes an LA Ram. I see no way Ndamukong Suh becomes a Ram. So, you know, it happens. But with this situation specifically, I don't think DeSean Jackson becomes a Ram. I truly do not. Also wanted to point out that there's a percentage of Rams fans, I don't know how big of a percentage, but a percentage of Rams fans who are already up in arms that the Rams signed a quarterback who's 33 years old. DeSean Jackson, just a couple of months ago, did turn 34. So by that logic, I would think that these fans, the fans that are already a little bit I guess, worked up that the Rams have a 33-year-old quarterback now in his first season with the team, would not want a wide receiver, a skill position, a position that runs a lot and gets hit a lot, to be older than that. It just doesn't make any sense. I feel like fans would be upset at this move. I don't think it would go over well if the LA Rams went after DeSean Jackson. Age, the fact that we're wide receivers, a deep position group for the LA Rams. It's a little bit top heavy right now, but it is a deep group still. I mean, you can still technically count Josh Reynolds in that group right now, but if you just count Woods, Kupp, and Jefferson, that's already a pretty sweet trio. Jefferson, I mean, even week one, he had a really nice catch. It was on the left sideline against the Cowboys. Even then, it was like, okay, this guy can play football. And then we've heard the comments from Sean McVay talking about how amazing he is and stuff. So will we see him a lot more? Probably, because he's not going to be a rookie. We also know that under Sean McVay, rookies do not really get a lot of playing time unless they're safeties under the Sean McVay era. So I don't buy it. I'm not buying it. I'm selling that stock. DeSean Jackson of the Rams, sell. I'm not buying it at all. I do think that there are some other names that are intriguing, but ultimately, I don't think that the Rams are adders this year. I think that the Rams are kind of like, I feel like we're going to build up our own guys right now. Like, I feel like we're trying to take what we've got, take what we've built over the last few years as far as, you know, deep drafts and stuff, and kind of trying to get those guys more playing time. The Greg Gaines, the Jordan Fuller, the Terrell Burgess, the Terrell Lewis, you know, maybe even on the offensive line, there could be some guys. Who is the guy that he... Oh, I had the name earlier today. I should have just written it down. Who is the guy? He opted out on the offensive line last year. Oh, I'm totally blanking. I'm going to feel like a jerk when I remember. I mean, it's going to be the second I stop recording, it'll pop into my head. But he opted out last year, so there's depth there as well. I mean, I think that that's kind of what the Rams are going to do. They're going to try to progress some players, not necessarily add from everywhere else. Let's move on to the rest of the West before we get into our fan quesos. Actually, real fast, let me get some water in my face, and I will be right back with you guys. That's some high-quality H2O right there. So we'll get into the rest of the West. This is a segment that I kind of fell off of a little bit just because, you know what? This is Ram Showcase, not NFC West Showcase. Screw those other teams, all right? We want them to fail, all right? We want them to not do good jobs. That's as aggressive as I'll get. But let's take a look, all right? So we'll start with the Seattle Seahawks. Because this is the big one. This is the big story that's happening right now. All right, so Russell Wilson comes out on Dan Patrick. Dan Patrick, lots of love. One of my heroes. And he just kind of lets it leak out just a touch that he's a little unhappy in Seattle. All right, he's, you know, Schottenheimer, who has now been fired. Rams fans remember hashtag fire Shoddy. It was very popular amongst Rams fans. And that kind of started a trend in Seattle as well. The common denominator is Schottenheimer, so, I mean, whatever you, what I got to do with that information. But Russell Wilson, he let it kind of be known, like, hey, I'm getting hit too much. I don't have any say in the offense, and I don't like that fact, like those facts. Hard to blame him there. Hard to blame him. So it's becoming evident that the Seattle Seahawks and Russell Wilson have a little bit of a strained relationship, all right? And we can all see that that's happening. We can all tell that he's unhappy because he's been very quiet. He's ended every press conference and every time he talks to any media, he ends it with "Go Hawks." That's gonna change, I think. I think we see a change. I don't know where he goes. My original prediction was Colts, but now they have Wentz, so I don't think that that happens. I don't think that the Colts package Wentz. I mean, it's possible, I guess, but I don't think that that's necessarily something that happens. So it looks like Russ wants out. He wants out of Seattle, it looks like. And I think that they might be willing to oblige. I think that they might be willing to let that happen. And if this happens, I think that the Seahawks fight for third place. Russell Wilson is the best player that franchise has ever seen. Ever. He's the reason they're relevant. He's the reason they won the Super Bowl. He's the reason they went to that other one. He threw a pick to end that one, but that was more play call than Russ specifically. But per Mike Silver, if you guys know Mike Silver, he's the sassiest person on Twitter. That's the only word that I feel like is appropriate for Mike Silver, is sassy. The asking price, that's not a shot, by the way. I love Mike Silver. He's one of my favorite follows. But Mike Silver, he's saying that the asking price reportedly starts at 3 first-round picks. That is not unrealistic. The Rams just shipped off the number one overall pick and 2 firsts for Matt Stafford. This is absolutely possible. Jets? Possible. Could we see something with Houston, maybe? Deshaun Watson packaged in? Very possible. There are teams that can afford to give up 3 ones, that are willing to afford to give up 3 ones. Every team can afford to give up 3 ones. The Rams can give away 3 ones. You want 25, 20, you want, yeah, 24, 25, 26 first round picks? Yeah, do it. If it's the right player, I think the Rams would absolutely be willing to push that out. What would that give us, 10 years without a first round pick? That'd be fine. The Jets, prime, they could do that today. I think that would be a strong move for the Jets. Either way, it's not unrealistic that this could happen, all right? From the Rams' perspective, I think this would crush Seattle. I think it would crush them. It would crush their franchise because he is what's holding them together. The Seahawks are this weird little puzzle that's like kind of falling apart a little bit, but there's the gorilla glue, which is Russell Wilson holding this thing together. And I think if you get rid of that, I think there's too many loose pieces on that roster and on the coaching staff that I think it all crumbles down. Wilson, like I said, he's the best player that franchise has ever seen. They've seen some really good ones. Sean Alexander would be way up there as well. You can include Richard Sherman if you want to. I will not. I think Earl Thomas I would put up there. They've had some really, really good linebackers. Wagner's really good. You could look, like I said, you could look back to, I mean, you could go way back to like the Largent days and all that, but I think that it's, I don't really think it's that up to that much debate. Sean Alexander would be, I think, a legitimate debate, but I think Russell Wilson is the best player that franchise has ever seen. Maybe Marshawn Lynch you could throw in there as well, but I would say Russ is the best. So, I hate saying that. I respect the hell out of Russell Wilson, though, man. There's at least one player on every team that I have the utmost respect for and am I kind of a fan of. And for the Seahawks, that's Russell Wilson. I'm not a Seahawks fan by any means, but Russell Wilson, it's hard just not to respect him. He works hard. He plays amazing. He's a great guy. There's not a lot to hate about him, but I think he is what holds that team together right now. I don't think it's Carroll. I don't think it's Pete Carroll. I think it's Russell Wilson. And they refuse to help him. They refuse to give him offensive line help. They refuse to really give him weapons. You can say DK Metcalf now, but I think that even when they took him, I don't think that they knew what he was going to turn into. And then he doesn't get to participate in running the offense. He just has to do what's called. And, you know, maybe that's going to change now, but it doesn't sound like it, because it sounds like Russell Wilson's coming out and saying this stuff because he was maybe hoping that Schottenheimer leaving was like, oh, man, now I can maybe get a say in the offense. And then Pete Carroll maybe said no. And now it's like, okay, well, then just let me go somewhere else where I can actually play some ball then, you know. And Russell Wilson, I think when he can actually control it, it's going to be really, really exciting to watch. Hopefully it's an AFC team. You know, I would like, I won't be sad to watch Russell Wilson not play against the Rams 2 times a year. I'll tell you that much. But I truly do think that if he gets his wish and gets a new team, I think the Seahawks are fighting for third place. I think that's their battle, is the third place spot. Let's take a look at the 49ers. 49ers, they're still unsure at their quarterback position. So we could see, obviously, the Rams changed quarterbacks. The Seahawks could be changing quarterbacks, are likely to change quarterbacks. A team that's a little bit less likely to change quarterbacks, but it's in the conversation, is the San Francisco 49ers. They still don't know what they're going to do at their quarterback position, but it does feel like the more we don't hear anything out of San Francisco, the more that it feels like they'll continue to just roll with Garoppolo. And just kind of let that ride. Did my video get really bright? I feel like it's really bright. It's too far away from me. I feel I'm way back here, guys. I can't really tell. But it feels like the longer that we don't hear anything from San Francisco, the more it feels like they're just going to go ahead and keep Jimmy. But They could make a splash. I don't think it's really possible. There's still word about Deshaun Watson maybe going to the 49ers. I don't think that that happens. I think Watson actually goes to the Panthers. I think that feels like it's real. It feels like the Panthers are ready and willing to make the move and give what the Texans are asking for. And maybe Christian McCaffrey. I don't know, guys. I don't know. It's pretty weird out there for the 49ers, but they could see a coaching change or a quarterback change as well. Not a coaching change. That's not going to happen. Speaking of coaching changes, though, the Arizona Cardinals. There is no major news to report from the Arizona Cardinals, but I think it's relevant to let it be known that if the Cardinals miss the playoffs again or have another like they did in the 2020 season where they had a big stretch where they were playing like absolute crap, then I really think that Cliff Kingsbury, his seat's getting a little warm, all right? And I think with every loss, it gets just a touch warmer, just a little bit warmer. And the more that Kyler Murray, because he did improve year one to year two, which doesn't always happen for quarterbacks, especially going into that sophomore season, that's helpful. The move for DeAndre Hopkins, that's helpful. The defense, not very good. That does not help. But also, I mean, what are they doing that's exciting? I think that every loss that the Arizona Cardinals accumulate, I think that Cliff Kingsbury's seat gets a little bit warm. He's tied to Kyler Murray. We know that. So it really, I think, depends on Kyler Murray's season. If Kyler Murray comes in and at least he's doing his job and doing a lot of really good things, then I think that does play a big role in Cliff Kingsbury's future as the Cardinals head coach. But I don't, if I had to put some money on it, which I don't have to, but, you know, maybe I will, I would say that Kingsbury is the next NFC West coach that's out, which I don't think is that actually big of a stretch. Maybe this year, too. Maybe that's what I'll say, because saying that Kingsbury is the next NFC West coach out, I think that's too easy, actually. Now that I say it out loud, I think that's too easy. I'm going to say maybe this year that he's out. All right, guys, let's take a look at our fan quesos. I forgot to pull them up here ahead of time, but we are good to go. We got them up here now. So we have some good ones. We have some good fan quesos. Paul came in pretty good. We got Jason stepping in. Tyler again coming in. Joel, Chris, Felipe. Nice. All right, so we do have some good fan quesos for you guys. Those last few I have not checked. They've come in as I've been recording, so have not pre-screened most of these. So let's go ahead and start. This first one here comes from Paul. Paul wants to know, the best looking Rams quarterback in history. I think, weird question, but hey, we're off season, so we're going to do this. This is where we're at now in the off season when it's February 24th and you're recording a podcast for the NFL for one NFL team. These are questions that you answer. Not a complaint, by the way, Paul. Best-looking quarterback in Rams history. I think that if you took a poll, I think that poll would say Jared Goff. But I think that you also have to look at Keith Null, who's the best quarterback in the history of the universe. And I think I'm trying to think here, because I don't really know. But I'm trying to think of, like, what would be, like, what... I mean, I think you'd have to go back. I think you'd have to go to, like, way back to, like, Vince Ferragamo, Roman Gabriel. I think that would be a legitimate answer that people would give. I don't know about Mark Bolger. Kurt Warner, I think people would say. I know that I have a Facebook friend. I'm not going to say names because I don't want to put anybody, like, out there. But I have one Facebook friend who's, like, absolutely in love with Kurt Warner. She's a Rams fan. She's just crazy about Kurt. So I would say that one for sure. That's probably it. Okay, so we'll go Jared Goff, Keith Null for obvious reasons because he's the best in the universe, and then Kurt Warner, Ferragamo, and Gabriel. We'll put, if I had to rank them, off-seasons get weird on Ram Showcase here. We'll go the top three, Jared Goff, Kurt Warner, Rome Gabriel. There you go. Next one from Paul. What do the Rams fans do on night one of the draft when they don't have any picks to make? Honestly, just relax, man. And it's so nice. It's the least stressful day of the year for Rams fans because we just get to sit back. We almost had a one a couple years ago. We traded it to the Falcons like last second. And it was like, it was one of those where like our pick was coming up and it was like, hey, we're going to do this. We're getting it, you know? And then it was like, oh, we traded it. All right. And then Still have not seen a first-round pick since Jared Goff. So it really is just a relaxing night. What I do myself, what do I do on night one of the draft? I just keep up with the storylines. I just watch where these guys who we just watched in the combine, which is like, I air quote that because what even is a combine in a pandemic? But, you know, we see all these guys that are performing. We see these storylines come out. We inevitably see, like, in April, all like a couple of stories, like 1 week before the draft of like, oh, this guy used to punch toddlers in the unit. Like, I don't know. Whatever story releases the week of the draft usually comes in and there's like, oh, what's going to happen to his stock? Is he going to be like, he was supposed to go number 12 overall. What's going to happen? Oh, he's going 14 now. You know, stuff like that. So yeah, I watch it for the storylines, but it is a very relaxing night. It's not stressful as a Rams fan to watch day one of the NFL draft. Not anymore, at least, because we used to be top five every year. So you know what? This is way less stressful. I'll take this. Paul, next question. Any early candidates for great Rams-related fantasy football team names? Oof. Didn't think of this one, man. I read this one early, forgot about it, and do not have any answers for you. Fans, I need you guys here. Listeners, I need you guys. Drop your suggestions. You know, when Todd Gurley was here, Two Gurleys, One Cup was a favorite. Goff My Lawn was a favorite, but obviously we can't use those anymore. There's some stuff you can play with Woods and Cup. Maybe Stafford. I'll have to look at that one, see if there's any Stafford ones. But this is actually, I have decided, Paul, for whatever it's worth to you, this is the year that I stop playing fantasy football because I do not care about it at all. And I do have somebody that's reached out to me that will maybe do a fantasy football segment on Ram Showcase this season. We'll see how that goes. I have never had anybody else participate in Ram Showcase, so I'm a little bit nervous, but we'll see what happens. We are coming up, though. We got like 2 weeks away, something like that, a little more than 2 weeks, from the five-year anniversary of Ram Showcase. We'll go live for that, actually. I'm actually excited about it. This next one here comes from Jason. What's one thing about our new quarterback that most of us don't know? Ugh. I'll be real with you, man. I kind of hate this question. I've had this a few times. The reason that I hate it, because I don't want that to sound like I'm being a jerk to your question or anything. It's because I don't know, and I don't really care. I don't care what he does in his own time. I'm a fan of him because he plays football. I hope he does really well for the LA Rams this year. But as far as on the football field, maybe this is something you guys don't know. This is actually something I learned, I think, yesterday. Is that Matt Stafford is actually, he's got the most game-winning drives in the last decade. This one comes from Tyler. Tyler's got the next five here. So let's see, or four, I think. Tyler's question, who's going to be the breakout star for the Rams in the 2021 season? He's guessing Jefferson or Gaines. I'm definitely going Jefferson here. I think Jefferson's going to have a pretty big year. I think that the quarterback change kind of benefits him in a weird way. But also, I mean, we've heard the comments from Sean McVay. Sean McVay is a big fan of Van Jefferson. And the way that he talks about Van Jefferson, it's like, then why don't you play him more? he ups him so much. It's like, well, put him out on the field then. Throw him the football, Sean. What are you doing? So I think that the quarterback change actually kind of benefits him because I think Jared Goff really kind of locked in on Woods and Kupp. And Higbee a little bit. So I think the quarterback change going to Stafford, I think that does benefit other guys, such as Van Jefferson, and if Gerald Everett comes back, which I don't think he does, but I think it would benefit him as well. And let's go with a defender. I'm going to give you two here, but it's going to be the opposite. I think a surprise cut is what I'm going to give. And then, I want to say Micah Kizer. I think he did a really good job this last year, though. You know what? Maybe I'm gonna go with Terrell Burgess, the safety. I think John Johnson leaves, and I think that opens the door for Terrell Burgess to come in and get a lot more playing time. And I think I'm gonna go with him as far as the breakout defender. I'm gonna give you a surprise cut though on the defense as well. And I know this is not your question; it's literally like the opposite of your question. But I'm gonna answer this one anyway. I think a surprise cut this year, Taylor Rapp. Taylor Rapp did not get better year one to year two. He is a safety and is terrible in zone coverage. doesn't really tackle that well, does nothing spectacular. And I don't want it to sound like I'm just taking shots at Taylor Rapp, but I want to see him play so much better, and he's just not there. And I like Taylor Rapp. I think his story's really cool. I think he's really cool. But I'm not seeing that progression, that fire. I don't see it in Taylor Rapp. There's something about watching Taylor Rapp play that just makes me nervous. I feel like especially in the Rams secondary, he is a weak spot when he's out on the field. He does not do a very good job in zone coverage. He's only okay in man coverage. I think he's a liability, and I think for that reason, I think he gets cut when it comes to cut time, which is right before week one, really. Because who knows if we're going to have a preseason this year. We'll see, I guess, but that's a little ways away, so we'll see what happens. With all the new hires, which ones gain your interest the most? Let me pull up the list here, actually. I was not prepared for this one right now. Because the Rams lost people, and that is super unfortunate. Let me make sure no sound's going to come out of that. And some of the guys that the Rams did lose is not good. Not good. So Aubrey Pleasant, Joe Barry, those are huge losses to the LA Rams. Carberry, which is who you did say for the offensive line, I think that's a decent addition. I don't want to down him, of course. I that's not the intention by any of that, by any means. But, you know, man, I would say, oh, man, I'm trying to think. What, I don't even know how to pronounce his last name. The new special teams coordinator, Joe something. I mean, he's got an amazing first name. What is his last name? Is it here? Is it on this page? It's not on this page. All right, so DeCamillus? I don't know. He calls himself Joe D. We'll just call him Joe D. I'm not going to waste all your guys' lives. I think that's the one that I'm most excited for. And a big part of that is actually because of the Rams special teams this year, we saw zero fakes. And that was like really disappointing to me. And like we got into the playoffs and it was like, all right, we have to see a fake here, right? Like we're in the playoffs. Like this is all or nothing here. And Johnny Hecker can throw the football. I mean, I don't want him starting at quarterback or anything, but he can throw the football. And I think that it's a threat that we were absolutely missing this season. We went 10-6. Who knows what could have changed if Coach Bones was still in town calling those fakes. And he was creative with his fakes. Not only creative with the fakes, but creative on the returns. I mean, you guys remember the Stedman Bailey touchdown against the Seattle Seahawks where Tavon Austin like fell down and the ball was on the other side. Stead runs it all the way down. You know, we remember that stuff. But Joe has come out and said that he wants to bring back more fakes. And that alone was like, all right, I am in. Let's do this. So I'll say that he's the one that interests me the most as far as the new additions on the coaching staff. The other ones are just position coaches and assistants. So for that reason also, I think that he's just the highest impact coach that the Rams have brought in. Your next two here, Tyler, you're going to hate my answers for. Who do you see us trading with, and who are we trading? I have no idea, dude. This is not something that I necessarily get into. It's like the guessing game of like who would we trade with, because I don't know what Les Snead's brain is like. And, I mean, under that magnificent hair, I have no idea what's going on. So I could give like my opinions of who I would maybe target in a trade, but I also, like I said a little bit earlier, I don't think that this is a year of the Rams adding a bunch of pieces in. Okay, our quarterback was a weak spot last year. We addressed that. What else is there? I mean, we're going to lose a couple of people. We're going to lose Leonard Floyd. We've got guys that can kind of come in that spot, at least rotationally. And then we're also pre-free agency and draft, so we're going to be fine there. Safety, we're probably going to lose John Johnson. But we've also already got Burgess sitting on the bench. We have Rapp, who has the experience. I do think that he gets cut. It's at least possible, okay? Maybe I won't say that. Maybe I don't know if he's going to get cut or not. I don't know what the coaches' conversations look like as far as these guys go. But I would say that I think he possibly gets cut. But we lose some guys, but we in those positions, we already kind of have guys that could come in and fill in. Morgan Fox is a name that would be a difficult name to replace. He's a very strong rotational player, but he is that a rotational player. So as far as who would I trade for or who do I think the Rams will trade for, I really don't know. I haven't really gotten there yet. I'm also waiting to see who's getting cut. Who's getting cut? Because there could be guys that we want that are maybe under contract right now that are going to be cut tomorrow. We have no idea. So this is a little bit of a waiting game right now. And I think really what's happening right now is my brain is in Rams free agents mode. I'm thinking of these guys right here. Who's coming back? Who's not coming back? Let's figure this out kind of thing. And I realize that that's a terrible answer. And I realize that I didn't really answer your question at all. But I am going to move on. All right. This one comes from Joel. These are where I have not read the questions, by the way. Starting now. So Joel's question, can we place the transition tag on Williams? And if we do, what tender do you think we do? So transition tag, I don't think we would use the transition tag on Williams. First of all, though, as far as like a tender, with the transition tag, you do get first right of refusal. So whatever offer he is offered, you can match that. But if you don't, it's gone. You don't receive anything. So with Williams specifically, he is a restricted free agent. So we can place a tender on him because he's a restricted free agent. But as far as a transition tag goes, instead of the average salary of the top five at that position, like the franchise tag, the transition tag is the top 10 salaries at that position. That player would get paid. So for that reason, I don't think that the Rams would do this because corners are getting paid right now. And the averages, I mean, Ramsey jumps that average up a lot. But also, I wouldn't want to see what other teams offer him because he could be the number one guy on a lot of teams. I won't say all because that's just not true. But on a lot of teams, he would be the number one guy. So I think other teams are going to be really willing to pay him. So if the Rams put the transition tag on him, then we would have to match that offer, and I think we would just lose him. So with the restricted free agent tender, we could slap a one on him. Of course, we'll pay a little bit more, but we could get him pretty cheap for the 2021 season, and I think that would really be the way to go as far as keeping Williams in the LA Rams organization, which is definitely what we want to do. So for that reason, I don't think a transition tag would be the right move for Darius Williams. I think that just slapping a tender on him with the restricted free agency rider that he's got, I think that's going to be good. This next one comes from Chris. Again, have not read these before. There's a bunch of question marks in this one, though, so we'll have to break this one down. Let's run through it first. Considering all the losses we've had from the coaching staff, what does that tell you? Is it that the NFL is a copycat league just trying to be successful like the Rams? Or is it just all just on the Rams, knowing who they need and want on their staff? Or does it fall under Sean McVay success umbrella? I'm trying to figure this question out. Hold on. Okay, so we'll start knocking off questions. All right. Considering all the losses we've had to the coaching staff, what does that tell you? It tells me that the Rams coaching staff has been strong since Sean McVay has arrived, and people are noticing that and wanting to promote these guys. And we didn't have the positions open. You know, we didn't have a head coaching job open. Brandon Staley wanted to be a head coach and was offered. So yeah, I mean, he gets to go do that. I think that the Rams are just really, really good at finding guys that fit in this team. And we've already seen Zach Taylor that it doesn't work everywhere else. Just because they did a good job here and fit in with what we were doing here does not mean that that translates to other teams. I think Zach Taylor will do fine eventually, but I do think he caps out as an offensive coordinator, really strong offensive coordinator. I don't think he belongs necessarily as a head coach. But also that roster is a friggin' mess, so who absolutely knows? Let's see. Is it just that the NFL is a copycat league or just trying to be successful like the Rams? Obviously, everybody wants to be successful like the Rams. But also, the Rams want to be successful like other teams that are better. So, I mean, like the Packers. I mean, it's just a thing, man. Everybody's going to... If somebody sees something that works, people are going to do it. Rams don't play starters in preseason. Now you see some other teams doing it. Rams blowing off number first-round picks, number ones all day. You're going to start seeing other teams doing it because Rams are doing fine. All right, so first round picks are going to lose their value, and I think the Rams are that first domino. We punch that domino over, that's just going to keep on happening. There's going to be some other teams that are just going to be like, oh, ones? We don't need these. Like, especially teams that have a history of not doing a good job with their ones. And I think that's going to continue to happen. The Rams are ahead of the curve on a lot of those things, though, as far as, you know, the not playing starters in preseason. And, of course, like I just mentioned, the trading first-round picks, because we just don't really value them as much as other people do. Like, other people see this, and they're like, what? You got this? And I'm like, yeah, I guess. Like, do you want it? Like, what do you want for it? Like, you know what I mean? So, I don't know. That was a weird example, but I stand by it. Let's see here. It was just on the Rams knowing who they need and want on their staff. I mean, Sean McVay, he's been around long enough and has enough connections. And with the guys that the Rams do have on the staff right now, if a guy's available, like he knew Raheem Morris. So, I mean, if a guy comes available, he knows that Raheem Morris can fit in with him. So, I mean, just pull that trigger. Does it fall under the Sean McVay success umbrella? It all falls under the Sean McVay success umbrella. Everything does. The entire Rams success right now falls under the Sean McVay umbrella. Do you remember what life was like pre-Sean McVay? The very last year before Sean McVay was 4-12, and we felt decent about it. At least I did. I like, for a Jeff Fisher getting fired in season, it was like, okay, well, we won those four, though, and we started 3-1, so it was, you know, we were headed in the right direction, and then it came crashing down. So, I mean, the fact that the Rams' worst season under Sean McVay was 9-7 and barely missing the playoffs, and that felt like a huge failure, going 9-7 and barely missing the playoffs. From what the Rams came from, I mean, we have nothing to complain about. If you've been a Rams fan for years, even if you just go back to like 2003 and on, or if you wanted, like if you started being a Rams fan, Super Bowl, Greatest Show on Turf days, if that's when you started, you should be stoked about what's happening right now with Sean McVay. He's done so much. It's a culture change. It's not just Sean McVay calling some exciting offensive plays like the hook and ladder against the Packers or anything like that. It's a culture change. This team feels like winners now. It's disappointing when we lose a game. So everything's just different right now, and that'll all go back to the Sean McVay umbrella. That's my point. My video cut off, so I had to restart. Sorry about that weird cut, guys. Let's see here. Last one here comes from Felipe. What are your thoughts on the Rams getting DeSean Jackson on a one-year deal? I should have read this one before I actually asked it. I already answered this one, man. I had a whole segment on it, but I'll give the briefest rundown of it because I know that was maybe a little convoluted, whatever the heck that means. But I would say I don't buy it. I don't buy the rumors of DeSean Jackson coming to the Rams. First of all, in a one-year prove-it deal, that's the words I keep seeing. He's 34. Was it, like, prove it? He's done great things in this league. He doesn't need to prove anything. He's a good player. So a prove-it deal, by those words, doesn't make any sense to me. On a one-year deal, I don't think it's relevant. I don't think we need him for 1 year. I don't think it's really worth it. He's 34, and we already had fans crying about getting a 33-year-old quarterback, and this guy's getting hit and running routes and, you know, all that stuff. So I think this looks a lot worse as far as those fans who think that 33 is old, which makes me feel weird. I'm only 29, but I feel like anybody who's like 33 or over is like, what? That's old? Like, you know, because I'm starting to feel it. I'm as old as Aaron Donald. I already said that, but it still makes me feel like crap. But no, I see. This is my rundown on the rumors of DeSean Jackson coming to the Rams on a one-year prove-it deal. Is, first of all, it makes no sense. He doesn't have anything to prove. He's done a good job. Second would be, I don't buy it at all, because the rumors originated from an article that was titled, "Three Teams That Should Be Interested in DeSean Jackson, Not Three Teams That Are Interested in DeSean Jackson." And third, the Rams fans there's a percentage, a group of Rams fans who are already mad that the Rams got a quarterback who's 33. Why would they be okay with a guy coming in at 34 at a position that gets hit a lot more? So I don't see any reason why the Rams would do it. All right, guys, thank you for your fan quesos. I do appreciate it so much. It's always appreciated. You guys can feel free to drop those in the comment section below or to the side, wherever the heck you're listening. I don't know where they're at. But drop them either way, and I'll answer them on the next show. It's only one reason I will not get to your fan quesos, and that's only if I have like a billion of them. So like we're going about over almost an hour today, but that's plenty. I mean, we got time. I try not to go over 1 hour. I feel like if I take up more than 1 hour of you guys' lives, that's just too much. That's too much Joe for you guys. You guys don't need that much Joe in your life. Ask my coworkers. So that is going to do it, though, for fan quesos and the rest of the show, actually. It's all over now. It's all over until next week, and then we're back again. But either way, thank you guys so much for spending some time with me on this beautiful Wednesday. If you guys are watching the video, it's a Thursday or Friday or Saturday or Sunday. I don't know when you're watching this, but I hope you guys enjoyed yourselves either way. Drop a comment below. Let me know what your favorite city to live in has been, whichever one you've lived in that you like the most, and why you're a Rams fan. We'll do that. We'll do that one. I didn't get anybody last week, but I'm just going to keep on asking you guys where you guys live. I'm in Fountain, Colorado, the home of the Rams' very own Morgan Fox. Got his jersey sitting over here. So that's good stuff. But let me know where you guys are from. Hope you guys are rocking the bone gray like myself. But that is going to do it for me. I think you guys should follow the Ram Showcase on all your favorite social media. That would be at Ram Showcase on Instagram and Twitter. Facebook.com/Ram Showcase. You can follow myself as well at Sheriff Joe Bags on Instagram and Twitter. Facebook.com/Sheriff Joe Bags. Pretty simple stuff there. But I do appreciate you guys listening. You guys are my favorite people in the entire universe. And don't tell those other people that I said that, but you guys are my favorite, all right? But that is going to do it for me. I am Sheriff Joe Bags. This has been Ram Showcase on Sports War Radio. For those of you who aren't Rams fans, thoughts and prayers are with you. For those of you that are Rams fans, thank you guys so much for listening, and you guys have a great night.